Hi, welcome to Heart of the Home. Today we're going to be discovering treasure and we will be making Asian chicken salad. So I think you're going to really enjoy this episode. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you and we thank you so much for today. We ask, Lord, that you would show us, Father, how to be content in our life, Lord. We pray that you would use your word to teach us and show us your way, Father. We thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. What better treasure in life could there be other than Jesus himself? Then perfect contentment. Well, that's our word for today, contentment. And what I wanted to show you as a tip for today is our concordance. And as I've been showing you little pieces like the Bible commentary last week, and these are really great tools for a Christian in studying the Word of God. Now, there's something called Blue Letter Bible on our phones. You can do as an app. They also have this in that too. We like books, and it's just nice to have sitting out when you're doing studies instead of constantly going back to the phone and or your laptop or whatever. So anyways, I just wanted to share with you what content and contentment is in the Bible. I mean, what the concordance does. Strong concordance takes a word and it shows you all the scriptures that that word comes in. So you can cross-reference what you're doing when you're studying, which is really neat and really applicable. And in this one, content, there are 13 verses that have that word content in it. And then down below it says contentment. There's only one verse for contentment. And so it will tell you exactly where to go. It tells you what it is. Godliness with great gain is contentment. Isn't that awesome? Godliness is great, is with great gain. Sorry. Anyways, so that's the concordance, A to Z, every word in the Bible. And so I hope you enjoy that and you can get one. It'll really help you out a lot. So let's go on back. Contentment brings joy, peace, harmony, gratefulness, and appreciation. Paul is a great encouragement to me because as we get to know Paul in our readings, we begin to understand that he has been through much difficulty and pain in his ministering life. In 2 Corinthians 12, 7-9, and that's what I'm going to have you guys look up, 2 Corinthians 12, 7-9, "And lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, a messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I be exalted above measure. Concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord three times that I might depart, that it might depart from me. And he said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness.' And yet, he also learned how to be content with that. Let's look at Philippians 4:11. So there's two scriptures this time. Philippians 4:11. And this goes hand in hand with what we just read. "Not that I speak in regard to need, for I have learned, remember, in whatever state I am, to be content." Isn't that amazing? Now, Philippians is after 2 Corinthians, so obviously he's had this thorn in his flesh. He's been through many trials, and yet he's learned how to be content in everything. So, this tells us, in case you were wondering, that it's not just a personality trait we're born with. Being content is something we learn to be. Paul has learned this. It is indeed a quality that needs to be nurtured, taught, and caught. Discontent, on the other hand, starts when we're not satisfied with things. Psalm 63:5 says, "My soul is satisfied as with marrow and fatness, and my mouth shall praise you." What we crave physically cannot compare to the richness of God's provisions. Discontent is what begins in the heart of a person not happy with her lot in life. When our hearts are restless for God and we do not seek Him, we often chase an impulse without much thought. We need to reinvent ourselves. It could start with a whisper. I'm not thin enough. I don't have a perfect nose. My hair is too thin, thick, wavy, straight. Things are another area of discontent. It may be something someone else has. I need a new car, a better home, a new outfit. It could be even a shopping spree that leaves you with less money and more junk. Possessions and reinventing ourselves are a temporary salve for a restless heart. Funny thing, you know, my husband and I found out that if we stood for a bit looking at something in the store, we all of a sudden had a group of others interested in the same item. We all want what others want. And if our hearts are not first focused on our Lord, we look everywhere else for satisfaction. But this stirs in us a discontented spirit. What happens after discontent is stirred up? Numbers 14:27 talks about the Israelites in the desert. God had provided all their needs. All their needs had been met, but they were not content. Their complaining, which is what happens to a discontented heart, was heard by God, and God was angry with them. What in essence they were saying was that what God provided for them was not enough. You see, contentment depends largely on how much we trust God. Proverbs 3:5-6 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path." Complaining springs from an ungrateful heart. There is much to be said of the complainer in God's Word. Proverbs 27:15, and remember, Proverbs is the book of wisdom. Proverbs 27:15 says, "A continual dripping on a very rainy day and a contentious woman are alike." Proverbs 21:19 says, "Better to dwell in the wilderness than with a contentious and angry woman." And Proverbs 25:24, "Better to dwell in the corner of the housetop than in a house shared with a contentious woman." I'm reminded of an old saying I used to hear growing up. When some older people were asked how they were doing, it was often said, "Can't complain." There was a sweetness about it and a contentment that came with it. If we could start making a disciplined thought in our hearts and heads to rejoice in the blessings we do have, it becomes harder to complain about what we do not have. There are many complaints in the Bible, godly men and women who desired something desperately, but the difference with them is that they took their complaint to the source of their answer, God. If we turn to our friends, family, and in some cases, any listening ear, to vent and grumble, we can alienate many, or even worse, become a grumbling party that only adds to the discontent. Learning to be content is a habitual behavior. We need to discipline our minds to focus on God in our lives, going to Him first, praying over our need, leaving it at His feet, trusting Him with the plan of how, what, and when it will be taken care of. We were made for more than this world has to offer. Our longings, cravings, hopes are telling us something. There's not ever going to be enough of anything on this earth to satisfy us. Philippians 3:20 says, "But our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we eagerly await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ." Why fill this temporary home with temporary things? We're talking about, right now, a lifestyle of pursuit of other things. Not the basic care of yourselves and your homes. That needs to be done. We need to take care of ourselves. We need to take care of our homes. We need to take care of our homes, our cars. Buying things for your home or self are not in and of themselves evil. It is when God is no longer a part of your decision and life. We will always want more if we're seeking to fill the void with anyone but Him. That can't be totally filled until we meet Jesus and we become, and he becomes our all in all. In Psalm 63:1 it says, O God, you are my God. Early will I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh longs for you in a dry and thirsty land where there is no water. As David's soul was, so should our souls be, longing for God to refresh, satisfy, and fill us. So let's go back to the title of our teaching, Discovering Treasure. Contentment is unbelievable treasure. With it comes great worth, peace, joy, happiness, and satisfaction. Matthew 6:21 says, For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The Lord is the treasure. His word is the way. And Psalm 119:162 says, I rejoice at your word as one who finds great treasure. Let us end with something Hannah Whittle Smith said. The greatest lesson a soul has to learn is that God and God alone is enough for all its needs. This is the lesson that all God's dealings with us are meant to teach, and this is the crowning discovery of our entire Christian life. God is enough. No soul can really be at rest until it has given up dependence on everything else and has been forced to depend on the Lord alone. As long as our expectation is from other things, nothing but disappointment awaits us. Feelings may change, doctrines and dogmas may be upset, the Christian work may come to naught, prayers may seem to lose their fervency, promises may seem to fail, everything we have believed in or depend on may seem to be swept away, and only God is left, just God, the bare God, if I may be allowed the expression, simply and only God. If God is what he would seem to be from his revealings, if indeed he is the God of all comfort, if he is our shepherd, if he is really and truly our Father, if, in short, all the many aspects he has told us of his character and his ways are actually true, then we must come to the positive conviction that he is, in himself alone, enough for all our needs, and that we may safely rest in him, absolutely and forever. Hi everyone, welcome back. We are going to be making Asian chicken salad today. And this is a really, really easy, really quick meal. I'm trying to make things that you guys can just quickly do because I remember being a mom and having kids and I was always under the 30 minute, okay, if this takes 30 minutes, we can get it done, you know? So anyways, this takes a little bit longer actually than 30 minutes total, but what I would do is I would do the chicken the day before because it needs to be cold anyway, so you need to refrigerate it. So I'm gonna show you real quick how I do the chicken so you guys kinda know, because I've already made it ahead of time because it does take time. So I'm gonna tell you that I get three stations ready. I do a plate for the flour, and I put the cup or 2 cups of flour here. Usually a cup is enough for two chicken breasts. Now, let's start with the chicken breasts before we go any further. I cut my chicken breasts into very small pieces. I'm gonna show you what they look like after they've been cooked and breaded. Let me show you real quick. Because in a salad, you don't want big strips of chicken. So they're just little bite-sized pieces, nuggets, really. The kids will love them. But it's time consuming because they are so small, but not so bad. I'll tell you why. So you take your chicken and you slice it. And I've also found out another little thing about chicken. If you keep it a little, if it doesn't thaw all the way and it's slightly frozen, so much easier to cut. So much easier. It's not wet and wiggly and, you know. So anyways, I'm not a big chicken lover cooking with chicken because I don't like the feel of it. So when it's frozen, it works out great and it cuts really nice. So you can cut the chicken into like 4 slices and then again, real small one, not even 1 inch pieces. So you've got quite a bit. As a matter of fact, 2 chicken breast made a ton of fried chicken, probably more than I would use in the salad today. But it's your family, how many you need and what you need to do. Try two at first, because you can always use the extra for sandwiches or whatever. The kids will use them as dippers, you know. So that's that. So you've got your chunks of chicken, raw chicken. And what you're going to do is you're going to take that raw chicken and you're just going to put it, all of it, into your plate of flour, and you're just going to smush it all in there and get it all floured up as best you can. Now, they're going to kind of stick together. So at this point, I only took half of that. I'm thinking now, I remember. I only did half of it because had you done the whole thing, they would really be stuck together and stuff. So I did half of it. And then I took them out, shook them up a little. I used my spider, if you remember me talking about the spider last week. And I shook it off, and then I put it into my milk and butter and salt. And don't forget, we seasoned the flour also. It's on your recipe. But then you stick it in the milk batter, and you can put it all in at the same time and just twirl it around. So it isn't like one piece at a time kind of thing. You can do it this way. So then you're going to take it out of the milk. And at this point, then I use my tongs. And I take each piece as best I can. They're kind of sticking at this point because the flour and the egg. Put it into your, now you're putting it into your breadcrumbs. And you're going to, you know, toss them around and get those breadcrumbs on. After the breadcrumbs, and I know this sounds like a lot, it's really not, you guys, it didn't take that long. You're going to take them and you're going to set them on a cooling rack. And you want them to dry just a tad, not very long, just, you know, 5 minutes or so, while your oil is heating. So you're going to do this in at least a couple batches, depending on how big your skillet is. And then you're going to put them in your skillet and you're going to fry them. Takes between 3 and 5 minutes. They're so small, so little, it doesn't take any longer than that. Then you're on to the second batch. While they're cooking, you're getting the second batch going. So I just wanted to show you what my station looks like when I'm doing that. I wanted to show you the bag that the salad comes in, and it is called Sesame Asian, and it's a kit. Now, honestly, you guys, this is me. You don't have to do this. It comes with a dressing inside. I don't like the taste of this dressing that much, so I don't use it actually. I use this dressing, which is Asian toasted sesame, and that is on your recipe, so don't worry about getting names and stuff. But this is the salad mix I use, you know, and it comes with croutons, not croutons, they're called wontons, and almonds. So I use those in it. And so I can just open that up real quick right now. Take this out. You can use that if you want. You know, it's up to you. Try it and see if you like it. It'll save you a little bit, I guess, rather than having to buy this. So it's up to you. I just like the flavor on that one. So I don't think in this little bag there's enough wontons. So, of course, I buy more wontons. So you can buy those too. So that's ready to go. Also, if you really want it crunchy and delicious, you can add chow mein noodles, which are crunchy and wonderful. So, and those things right there don't go on until you're ready to serve, because you don't want them drenched and yucky. You want them crisp and wonderful. So what we're going to do now is we're going to use the salad. Oh, this is my tip. This is a salad spinner. I don't know if anybody's ever seen one, but they're awesome. This is one, I can even remember the day we bought this. This was at least 25 years ago in Brea Mall. Pat and I were walking around, and there was a Tupperware venue. And I saw this and had never had one, and I thought, oh my gosh, that is so good. I would use that. I use it still, you guys, all the time when I make salads. It's awesome. It's got a little bucket in it where I put already. I don't trust salads that come in bags. I'm sorry. Some people just use them that way. I don't. I always rinse them and then put them in the spinner and spin it up. So this is the Asian salad mix. And what's in it is lettuce and carrots and cabbage. And that's what's in it. Now, to me, I always add extra lettuce because it makes it bigger and gives it more. So I add lettuce to that, which I'd already cut up and gotten ready last night. Another tip, you guys, if you want to cut up lettuce and have it ready for the next day, cut some holes in your baggie, put a wet paper towel at the bottom, and put your lettuce on top. And it keeps it nice and fresh. It doesn't go bad on you. It's really nice. So that's one extra tip for trying to get things done quickly and fast, right? All right, so we've got that. Let's mix it up. We're just gonna mix it up a little bit. And now we're gonna go ahead and add, and at this point right now, you guys, you could add green onions to this if you wanted. I didn't think about that. I would have probably, because I think green onions with it is good. And I think that's kind of an Asian flavor too. So we're gonna go ahead and pop some chicken in here. Not the whole thing, don't need the whole thing, but I'm gonna go ahead and put quite a bit, because we want to make sure that we've got a good salad going with lots of chicken in there. And so you can see that the nuggets are all about the same size, coated. What I love about that is, see, I'm not the biggest chicken fan. I know we've done a lot of chicken, and I like it. I'm just not the biggest chicken fan, but I like chicken with flavor. And so when you coat these little tiny pieces in all that breadcrumb, it's delicious. It comes out really good. So we're gonna go ahead and toss it again, just like that. I mean, it really comes together easy. Once the chicken is done, everything else is basically a toss in. You just have to toss everything in. So we're gonna go ahead and add, we're not gonna put the dressing on yet. We're gonna go ahead and add the wontons. And basically that's it. You can add the wontons. And we're going to also use this pack because it's got the almonds in it, and I like the almonds. I'm looking for a place to open it. There we go. And that really makes a really good salad too. So you could add sesame seeds. You could add sunflower seeds to it. Sunflower seeds would be awesome. So you kind of get to do whatever you want with it. So green onions, sesame seeds, sunflower seeds, whatever you want to do with that. More, you know, almonds is fine. So I'm going to go ahead and do some of these too, just because. Put some more crunch in there. You don't need a lot, just a few, just to give it some crunch. I had a lady tell me she loves my whoops. I do a lot of whoops, I think. Anyways, there it is. That's it. Now all we have to do is put the dressing on. Shake it up really well. And it's kind of a, well, you know, Asian, sweet. There's some ginger in there, and I'm not a big ginger fan, but this doesn't have a lot of it. It's just a really good flavor. It's also called marinade, so you can do both. You know, you can, you know, marinade your chicken in it, or your, you know, meat if you wanted to. And and that's just about it, you guys. Just mix it up, and you've got an excellent, delicious Asian chicken salad. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, again, we thank you for this day. We ask that you bless this food. And Father, we pray that these women would just be blessed with new ideas, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.